Shalom. Some people say that the God of the universe will give you whatever you want. I tend to agree with them. At the time of the Exodus, there was a Pharaoh. As the plagues came upon Pharaoh, he would relent and say the people could go. But once he had the respite, he hardened his heart and hearkened not unto them, as Yahweh had said that he would. This happened many times. In Exodus 9:12, it is written, "And Yahweh hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he hearkened not unto them, as Yahweh had spoken unto Moses." In Exodus 10:1, it says, "And Yahweh said unto Moses, Go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart, and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him." Pharaoh did not want to be drowned in the Red Sea. However, he did want a hard heart, and he hardened his heart, and then God hardened his heart. When the Israelites were in the desert, God provided food for them in the form of manna. Now the mixed multitude who were among them yielded to intense craving, so the children of Israel also wept again and said, "Who will give us meat to eat? But now our soul is dried away. There is nothing at all besides this manna before our eyes." So Moses went before the Lord and said, "Who is going to give these people meat to eat?" In Numbers 11, it says, "Therefore Yahweh will give you meat, and you shall eat. You shall eat not one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days, but for a whole month until it comes out of your nostrils and becomes loathsome to you, because you have despised Yahweh who is among you, and have wept before him, saying, Why did we ever come up out of Egypt?" So God did send them the food. A wind went out from Yahweh, and it brought quail from the sea, and left them fluttering near the camp, about a day's journey on this side, and about a day's journey on the other side, all around the camp, and about 2 cubits above the surface of the ground. And the people stayed up all that day, all night, and all the next day, and gathered the quail. He who gathered least gathered 10 omers, and they spread them out for themselves all around the camp. But while the meat was still between their teeth, before it was chewed, the wrath of Yahweh was aroused against the people, and Yahweh struck the people with a very great plague. So he called the name of that place Kivrot Hata'ava, because there they buried the people who had yielded to craving. Did the people want to die from a plague? No, but they wanted meat. They got meat. Why do we run into these difficulties when we ask for things and God gives them to us? In James 4:3, it says, "Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye might consume it upon your lust." In Jeremiah 17, we learn, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" Yahweh says, "I search the heart, I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings." There is another story in the Bible where the people demanded something that wasn't good for them. In 1 Samuel 8:5, the people came to Samuel and said, "Behold, you are old, and your sons walk not in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations." And Yahweh spoke unto Samuel, saying, "Hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them." And so Samuel tried to warn the people. He said, "This will be the behavior of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for his own chariots and to be his horsemen, and some will run before his chariots. He will appoint captains over his thousands and captains over his fifties, will set some to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and some to make his weapons of war and equipment for chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers, cooks, and bakers, and he will take the best of your fields, your vineyards, and your olive groves, and give them to his servants. And he will take a tenth of your grain and your vintage and give it to his officers and servants. And he will take your male servants, your female servants, your finest young men, and your donkeys, and put them to work. He will take a tenth of your sheep, and you will be his servants. And you will cry out in that day because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves, and the Lord will not hear you in that day." Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, "No, but we will have a king over us, that we also may be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles." So Yahweh said to Samuel, "Heed their voice and make them a king." The people were looking for security. As for me and my house, we serve only one king, the soon coming king, and we are promised also a crown. James 1:12, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him." 1 Peter 5:4, "And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away." Revelation 2:10, "Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life."
We will see the heavens open, a white horse comes in view, and the name of its rider is faithful and true. He has come to reign in righteousness, he'll judge and he'll make war. Yeshua is coming.